When international commercial disputes emerge, the preferred dispute resolution mechanism is arbitration. Now, there are a number of reasons why arbitration has achieved the status as the preferred dispute mechanism in this context. And one of the primary reasons for its appeal is because international commercial arbitration is underpinned by the doctrine of party autonomy. As Gary Bourne points out, this enables parties and arbitrators to dispense with the technical formalities and procedures of national court proceedings and instead fashion procedures tailored to their particular circumstances. The doctrine of party autonomy allows parties to choose whether or not to consent to arbitration and to choose the substantive law governing the merits of the party's dispute, the procedural law that will apply to the arbitration, and the procedures that will be followed during the arbitration. In short, the doctrine provides parties with the freedom to decide the terms on which they will arbitrate any disputes. This doctrine plays a central role in all aspects of the legal framework of international commercial arbitration. The cornerstone of this framework is consent. Parties typically consent to participating in arbitration by way of an arbitration agreement outlining the scope of the disputes to be referred to arbitration and the finality of the award. And it is this arbitration agreement that triggers the operation of the legal framework of international commercial arbitration. A key element of the framework is the United Nations Convention on the Recognition and Enforcement of Foreign Arbitral Awards, which is known as the New York Convention. This convention recognises the role of party autonomy in agreeing to participate in arbitration and in agreeing the arbitral procedures to be followed in the dispute resolution. Article 2 of the convention requires courts to recognise valid arbitration agreements and to refer a matter to arbitration when such an agreement is in place. Article 5, paragraph 1d permits non-recognition of awards that arise from proceedings that do not follow the party's agreed procedures. In terms of the national laws applicable, party autonomy enables parties to choose the substantive law to determine the merits of their dispute and to choose the procedural laws of the arbitration. They choose the procedural law by selecting the seat of arbitration. It is the arbitral law of the seat, known as the lex arbitri, that governs the procedural issues arising in the arbitration. As Bourne argues, in most nation states, the arbitration legislation implements the New York Convention by guaranteeing parties the freedom to agree on the procedural rules governing the arbitration. So, for example, if parties choose Australia as the seat of arbitration, then the relevant legislation would be the International Arbitration Act 1974. This act adopts the Unstrut model law, which brings the doctrine of party autonomy into Australian domestic law. So Article 19, paragraph 1 of the model law provides that parties are free to agree on the procedures to be followed by the arbitral tribunal in conducting the proceedings. Further, the model law recognises that party autonomy extends to issues such as selecting the place of arbitration, agreeing the number of arbitrators, and the procedures for appointing arbitrators. In addition to the procedural law that applies, parties have the freedom to adopt procedural rules from private arbitral institutions. These typically cover a range of matters such as the selection of the seat, the language to be used in the arbitration, and the composition of the tribunal and appointment process. When such institutional rules are adopted, they form part of the legal framework governing the arbitration. Alternatively, parties can choose to pursue ad hoc arbitration rather than institutional arbitration based on a set of these institutional rules. Finally, parties can agree on the so-called soft law they wish to apply to their arbitration. Soft law is the best practice guidelines that supplement the legal framework and deals with issues and procedures that may arise during the arbitration. For example, the International Bar Association has published rules on the taking of evidence in international arbitration. So party autonomy provides parties with considerable flexibility. There are, however, some limits on the exercise of party autonomy. These limits include not being able to avoid any mandatory aspects of the lex arbitri. So, for example, parties could not agree to arbitrate in relation to criminal matters in Australia, as such disputes are not arbitral under Australian law. As Michael Pryles argues, party autonomy would also not allow parties to make unacceptable changes to institutional rules. Such an unacceptable change could, for example, be attempting to remove the ability of the ICC court to review awards under Article 27 of the ICC rules. These few limits aside, however, the doctrine of party autonomy means that the legal framework of international commercial arbitration provides parties with considerable scope to determine how disputes between them will be resolved. The decisions that they make in exercising this autonomy can, however, have significant implications for the arbitral process and the outcomes. Accordingly, parties need to ensure that they have access to well-informed advice that understands the available options and the consequences which flow from these in order to make the best decisions in their circumstances.